Since the release of the works in 1984, you've been relatively quiet.
Yes, in a way. We did some touring last year. We did a big festival in Brazil, a Rock in Rio festival in January last year. And then later on in the year, we went on and we did a concert in Auckland, New Zealand, and some in Australia and some in Japan.
It's strange, actually. I think we added it up. And we added, between four or five concerts last year, we played to almost 1 million people, which is, you know, it's only a week's work. You know, it seems a very sort of efficient way of doing things, but...
You got involved in the movie Highlander.
Yes.
I've been alive for 4.5 centuries. I am immortal.
We initially said no because we just didn't want to be, we wanted a rest, to be honest. And then we saw about 20 minutes cut of this Highlander film and thought, great, that's us.
Now, we had the scripts and we went to see quite a lot of the footage that they got already. And then we all went away and all tried to write songs for various bits.
What actually moved me was the sort of subplot. The main plot is kind of violent tale of immortals fighting each other to the death up to from 15th century Scotland up to 20th century New York. That's the main plot. There's a kind of subplot which is a tragic love story, and it comes about because the hero cannot die, but nevertheless he falls in love with people who can die. So he falls in love with this girl in the Highlands, and she gradually grows old and dies in his arms, and he has to say goodbye to her, and he has to go on. It's a strange kind of tragedy, and that really came across to me very strongly, and I related it to my own life, I suppose, and everybody's life. I thought, you know, love always does come to an end at some time, you know. And so I had this song immediately in my head, which is called Who Wants to Live Forever.
There's no time for us. There's no place for us. What is this thing that builds our dreams, yet slips away from us?
So I ended up writing another slow ballad in a 6/8 sort of, which is called One Year of Love, and that's when he eventually decides to have another relationship with a woman again, because he vowed he never would again because it hurt him so much the first one.
We found plenty of things in the plot to jump off on, you know, and to get song, to write songs around.
Are you pleased that the new album, though, is not going to be a complete soundtrack album?
Yes, because I think the idea of a complete soundtrack album puts quite a lot of people off, really. I think they're imagining sort of all sorts of orchestral links, which don't really do anything. Just background music, which it isn't at all. It's a fully fledged Queen album.
We did all the music for the film first, and they dubbed it onto the film. Then when we came to do the album, we actually rearranged a lot of the tracks, made them, you know, longer, and, you know, wrote more lyrics and tried to make them into fully fledged songs. So they're, so they stand up in their own right, you know, without necessarily having to be with the film. You know, you could actually hear them on the radio, and they would sound like, you know, songs rather than actually more incidental music.
It's a kind of magic. It's a kind of magic, a kind of magic. One dream, one soul, one prize, one golden glance of what should be.
We all have our own ideas of how a song should be, because, I mean, a song can be done in so many different ways depending on who's doing it, but sometimes I just feel that it's not right. And like in case of Roger's track, which is Magic. I mean, he did it in a totally different way, which is quite good, but I just felt that there was another commercial streak, and I just realised that he was going away to LA for about a week, so I just got hold of it, and I just changed it around completely, and when he came back, I said, well, what do you think? And he said, oh, I like it. It was a completely different song, but, you know, something that sometimes you can see something else in other people's songs, and, you know, I don't mind them. They do that to my songs as well. They sort of, we all help each other in a way, but that's what then takes a lot of time. The whole thing was, I mean, it's like a group policy. First of all, the group couldn't agree on one single, because, I mean, it was to do with the film, and it was also to do with the new Queen product. Because what's happened, I think, for the first time in Queen's life, as it were, is that we've actually made a film soundtrack, but we've also made a Queen album. So we had to try and let people know that it's not just a soundtrack, because we've got other songs as well. So it was very hard to try and depict that it's not all one soundtrack, it's not just Queen. We had to try and bring two projects together. And so, I mean, within the members of the band as well, we were fighting as to who liked which song. So we couldn't agree at all. And basically what happened was, in the end, that we decided there should be two singles released simultaneously in different territories. And because the film is out in America first, we wanted to go with Princess, which goes with the film. But over here, we released Magic, because we thought that if we release Princess to go with the film, they're not going to see the film here till about July, and they're not going to know what it means. So sometimes you have to sort of get that diplomacy in and work out things like that. So in America, they've got Princess of the Universe. Over here, it's Magic.
One of the videos for a song called Princes of the Universe, which is about the people, not about us, it's about the people in the film who are immortal. You shot that video using bits of the film, but we sort of integrated the two by using Chris Lambert. And so he sort of, he's in the film, then he suddenly strolls and he's on stage with us and has a sword fight with Freddie and things, which is a nice way of integrating the film in a little bit. And instead of just cutting bits of film. I find that most actors are frustrated rock and roll stars. I know Chris Lambert is, and John Hurt's told me that loads of times. He's a rocker, really. Yeah. Or would love to be a rock and roll star. Oddly, isn't it? Most rock and roll stars want to be actors.
I was wondering if you're going to come back and say that.
I'm really bad at it as well.
To start off with, it was a Queen project as such anyway. But we did only like five tracks to go in the film, and then there's about nine tracks now. Is it nine? Yes, about eight. Yes, about nine tracks. So there's additional tracks which are not in the film. So it is a new Queen album anyway. I don't know what Queen stands for. I think it's four writers that write very different songs. And like, I mean, John's been writing quite a lot now, and he just writes in that one area which he likes, which is almost like a Tamla Motown or the sort of, and I love that because I love to sing on songs like that. So he's very different. I mean, you could never call his songs heavy or anything. I think Queen just write four very different types of songs. I'm like Brian writes from the guitar, so we have that element, and then Roger, I think, writes from the drums, or whatever. He sort of crosses over a lot, so we have all kinds of things.
I don't know where our motivation comes from, really, except I think we're all still trying to use this beast which Queen is as a vehicle to get our own ideas across, and we all write very different kinds of songs, and it's quite a challenge to get them through this kind of machinery and get them out. It's hard to explain. But for instance, for myself, if I write a song which has a particular idea behind it and I can hear it in my head, I've then got to take it to the other three and they will see it totally differently and want to do it in a different way. And some of their input will be very good and very necessary. And some of it will probably actually destroy the meaning of the song. So you've got to be, there's all this interaction going on all the time. And the motivation, the challenge is to actually get something across in the right way that moves people.
The question is like, you've achieved everything, what else is there? But the thing is, I have nothing else to do. I mean, I don't know, you know, I can't become a chef or something, you know, I don't know how to cook. So I have to sort of, and I know I can stop doing that and just live on my money, but I'm not that kind of person. I want to work, because I mean, I get so bored, you know, I'd be so bored. And so I was thinking that I know there'll be a time where I can't run around on stage because it'll be ridiculous, you know. I mean, I know when there comes a time when you have to stop. But music will still be my thing. So, I mean, I have to think in terms of what I can do. So maybe I'll go into production or I'll still write songs because, I mean, you can be quite old and not have... you can be... you might not have the physical fitness to run around on stage, but you can still write songs. So one way or other, the music side is always going to be in my life, you know.